Hey!
Hey! Hello!
Hello!
How you going?
Got the whole family, eh?
Yeah. Spat shalom.
Shabbat shalom.
Yeah.
How you guys doing?
Yeah, really good. Really good.
Sweet. Let me see if I can turn up the volume.
That's it.
How you guys doing? Hey, 5 kids, huh?
Yeah.
How do you do it?
It's not any different to 4.
I mean, you got to stay busy, man.
It's organized chaos.
Yeah, I hear that. Don't stay organized long, though.
That's it.
This is Layla and Zoe. It's my wife, Teresa, or Reese. And this is Dante and Malachi.
How are you guys?
Hi.
They're cool names.
Thank you.
Yeah. We've got Monica here.
Say hi.
And we've got Brandon.
Wait.
And we've got Luca up the end. Wait. And we've got Josiah. He's our eldest. Yeah, we've got this one on the floor down here.
Say hi.
Hi.
That's
Aaliyah. Hi, sweetie.
It's lovely to meet you guys, see you face to face.
Likewise. It's pretty cool.
Yeah. The encouragement you've been giving us on the internet and on all the clips and everything is just amazing. It's so uplifting.
Dude, man, the videos that you put out, man, it's pretty much all we got, you know what I mean? We watch your videos, and then on Shabbat, we go to Eliah.com, and the guy there, he does a live broadcast type thing. So, you know, we join in on that and stuff like that. Then they have, like, a little chat room where people get on there and so people can join in by phone, or, you know, he has the live video that he does. And that's it, man. You know, we've tried going to groups, but it's just weird, you know.
Yes.
We just stay just home, you know.
So you're in Texas, are you?
Yeah, we're in Texas. We are south of Dallas. And I think we figured out one time, I think we're like 3.5 hours from Colin. I think Colin is more on the west side of Texas. I'm not sure. But I know we figured it one time because he mentioned where he was and we were trying to figure out. And I think we figured out about 3.5-4 hours from where he's at. So yeah, you guys are a little bit of ways though. Well, it's morning time for you guys over there, huh?
Yeah.
Wow.
We're about 2,500 kilometers away from, well, the nearest believers we know anyway. So that's Chris and Victoria, Jason and Yuli, Matt and Lisa. They're all up in Queensland, up near the top, and we're close to the bottom, about, you know, quarter away up from the bottom.
So you're like 2.5 hours from them?
24 hours.
Oh, 24 hours.
2,500 kilometers.
I don't know what that is in miles.
What's his name? You're talking about Victoria and her husband?
Yeah, Chris.
Oh, Chris, yeah. You're 24 hours from them?
Yeah. Yeah, like 3,000 kilometers, like top of Australia, bottom of Australia, like.
Oh my gosh, I thought you like lived close by each other.
No, we used to.
We all grew up in Sydney, and then Chris and Victoria have been trying to get up to Cairns for years and years, but they had businesses and things, and they finally decided to do it. And they said to a handful of us who were friends, they said, do you want to maybe come up to Cairns, see what it's like? So that's up the top. So we all went up for a holiday. Put the cord down. we all went up there for a holiday and loved it. And so eventually, over about a year and a half, we all moved up there and spent about 6 years up there. And then we were running out of options and had made lots of mistakes in business. And so we sort of were looking for a new option. So we came back down to Sydney and my dad helped me set up a salon down here. And they're still all up there. And they got salons and so it's, yeah.
So the deal, that's like the whole family, huh?
Yeah.
Sweet. Yeah, no.
All our relatives are down here, but all the believers are up north. So we still. Yeah.
So now you're now selling the salon. Have you gotten any bites on that yet? Or?
Yeah, we got a couple of bites every couple of weeks. Yeah.
We haven't had any offers yet, though. Just a few people interested, so.
Yeah.
It'll all happen at the right time.
Yeah.
That's the father's just waiting to bless somebody with it, you know. Because that's a beautiful salon you guys have there, man. It's very nice, very impressive. And we had, you know, we went through issues ourselves. And we were in Florida for a while. And after a whole bunch of stuff happening, we ended up moving to Michigan. And thought it was going to be easy for me to find a job, you know, at a golf course mechanic and stuff, because Michigan has a lot of golf courses. But it was during the time when the economy started going downhill, and I filled out like 30 or 40 applications, and people were telling me, man, we would love to have you, but we just don't have the position, you know, things are really bad. And finally, we were down to like our last, 10, 15 bucks. And the people we were living with, they lived in a commercial building. And in Michigan, having a home-based business is really common. So they're like, you know, why don't you open up a small repair shop downstairs, you know? And downstairs, it used to be where they repaired wagons, like the iron wheels. It was like a blacksmith-type shop. And so I went downstairs, we cleaned it all up, painted the walls and clean, you know, I set up my tools and everything. And we put a sign up on the front, called it Lakeville Small Engine Repair. And it was like 2-3 days before we got our first customer. It was like the second day I was sitting there, you know, and that's when it all hit me, you know. It's like, oh my gosh, you know. We're homeless, we're broke, and nobody wants to come here. And I started crying. And then we heard some machine like up down the road and some guy bringing his lawnmower. Well, that week we made over 2,000. We made like over $2,000 that week. People were just bringing everything, man. It was crazy. They're bringing just weed eaters. And I'm like, you know, you can buy a new one for about as much as I'm going to charge you to fix it. They're like, oh, we don't care, you know. We just want, it used to belong to my grandfather and everything. And so we know what it's like, you know, when you start your business and then you have to, you put a lot of work into it. You know, it's a lot of work, man. It's, people think having your own business is easy and you don't have any bosses, but every person that walks through that door becomes your boss real fast, you know?
That's right. We're going through all that as well. Yahusha just makes you realize that, you know, you got to rely on him. He shows us through our business. That's what we've realized. You make stupid decisions, you know, like we made lots of stupid decisions. You end up stuffed.
So, yeah.
You don't treat your clients nice enough, you end up stuffed.
Yeah, sometimes you just want to whack them across the, hit them with an iron or something. But, it's one thing I've been reading lately, and I started reading after I watched the latest seminar with Lou White, the ethic or ethnic, the racist video.
Racist identity, yeah.
Yeah, and he mentioned something about Romans 12, and I thought, huh. So I read Romans 12, and I'm like, yeah, I need to start reading this to myself every night. So we've been reading that every night. You know, my wife and I in bed, we just read Romans 12. One thing we've been noticing is, like with the kids, you know, before their bedtime, we read Deuteronomy 5, you know, every night, and we pray and stuff like that. And then one thing we saw in scripture was, says, you know, you go to bed thinking about the commands, and you rise up thinking about the commands. And I'm like, man, so normally I wake up about 5:15, hit the door at 5:45, but yesterday I set my alarm to 5 o'clock just so I can have some extra time to start reading Deuteronomy 5 in the mornings too. But that's when I need it the most, is in the mornings. Going to work, you lose it real fast.
What's in store for me today?
What's that?
You go out happy. What's in store for me today?
Yeah. That you do that, you know, every day. Okay, put one up here, there's one up. What's wrong with that guy? He's slacking. Come on, get with it. But we just sit here and wait for your videos, you know. They're really good. But Lou White, and that dude cracks me up, man. He's hilarious.
Did I miss the part when you told us why you moved to Texas? Because last time when I walked out, you were in Michigan. What made you move to Texas?
From Texas, we moved to Virginia. And from Michigan to Virginia, and we were there for 4.5. We were there for 4.5 years. And then things at my job started changing. And at the golf course where I was at, you know, my old boss retired, new boss came in. And he just had his own ideas, his different agenda, you know. So we felt that it was time to make a move, and we just prayed about it, and the Father opened up a door in Texas for us. And the way everything worked out was just, I mean, it was just all him, you know, because we didn't have money or nothing to make any kind of move like that. But the way everything worked out, so now, you know, we're trying to figure out, okay, why we're here, and for what, you know. But while we've been here, we've grown a lot, you know, spiritually, together as a family, you know, and now we might be moving again. So.
Oh, really? Whereabouts?
To South Carolina. So I just had a job interview down there, and at a pretty, pretty high-scale golf course, so, which means, you know, a little bit more money.
Great.
But the way we're looking at it is just, you know, I used to be to where, make more money, you know, and Father's going to take care of you, man, no matter what, you know. It's not how much money you make, it's not what you bring in, it's trusting in Yahuwah, and He's going to take care of you no matter what, you know. Sometimes that's when we do better, is when we're making, like, barely scratching, you know, barely paying the bills. It seems to be when we're a little bit happier. But we, but, you know, it's just trusting in the Father, you know, and that He's going to meet your needs. Because in the end, He's your provider, you know, and everything. He's your healer, He's your provider, it's all you need, you know. And just learning more about that, you know, through the Eschaton series, you know, we've been watching that a lot. You know, it's funny because here lately, you know, the Lou White's been talking about the end times. And it's funny because, you know, my dad was a preacher, and he was a Pentecostal preacher. And we were born and raised in church and circus, you know, and all this time we've always been that it's just going to be scary and something to be feared.
Sorry. And can't make noise, it cuts out the microphone. Sorry. You're in the circus?
Yeah. And so, you know, it's like you're always taught that the end time is going to be so terrible and you know, people just like fear it. You know, and it's like going through the videos and reading about what it's really about, what's really going on. I mean, it's happening now, you know. It's right now here in Texas, I'm not too far away, that declared a health emergency because of the West Nile virus, mosquitoes, you know, they're carrying the West Nile, and it's tough. People have died already from it, and you know, and they're saying, oh, it's because of this and that. I'm like, no, you know, that's Yahuwah's judgment, you know, that's part of the plagues, part of what the end time is, you know, it's happening. And just like Brother Lou said, it's, you know, people want to make excuses as to why we're having earthquakes, why we're having all these fires. It's not us, you know, it's not the global warming. I mean,
Mother Nature.
But yeah, it's, you know, it was programmed, you know. But people don't see that, you know, and it's like, man, it's like we're so close, you know. It's any moment now, you know. It's Yahusha, the skies are going to split wide open, and there he is, you know. And that's so cool because I was at work today, you know, and thinking about that, I was listening to that on the radio, and I'm like, man, you know, and at the meantime, there's mosquitoes flying by me. I'm like, eek. But, you know, it's like what that scripture says, 10,000 will fall on your left, 5,000 on your right, but none of it shall come near you, you know, and it's like, yeah, you know, people are dropping. They got emergency, health emergency, I mean, just down the street. But, you know, people just need to start depending on Yahuwah for their healing, for their protection, you know. And it's real simple, man. It's just, I'm just so glad, you know, that he's just opened up our eyes, you know, because I used to know a lot of Muslim friends and stuff like that. I used to pick up my little King Jimmy, you know, and I used to tell them, if that guy up there can't take care of this book, what makes me think he can take care of me, you know? And because they used to sit there and tell me how corrupt it is and how mistranslated and how it ain't right. And buddy, I was a good little Christian, you know? But it's just, you know, when the Father opens up your eyes, when he really opens up your eyes to his truth, it's a lot of things start making sense. You know, it's just, see all the corruptness in the circus today, and people wonder why, or they don't even wonder at all. They just go with it, you know. And it's just being a preacher's kid, you know, I saw a lot of shady preachers, you know. And sometimes I just sit back and like, you know, yeah, okay. Did you want to say hi to the kids? The kids, say hi to your kids. They're going to be going to bed here pretty soon.
Yeah. How old is your eldest daughter?
Nine.
Fantastic. Josiah's 7.
That's your oldest?
That's my oldest, yeah. We got 4 boys, and the youngest is a girl. You got your eldest.
Malachi is the oldest.
Oh, Malachi is the oldest. Oh, it's because you're sitting further back, you look smaller. And how old are you, dude?
11.
11? Wow.
Yeah, he's 11 years old. And Zoe, oh yeah, she's 9. And he's 7.
He's 8.
Oh, he's 8. And then Layla is...
She's 9 months.
Oh, they're all gorgeous guys. And you go to school?
We're homeschooled.
Homeschool? Disgusting. So.
It's you guys homeschool too, right? You guys just started homeschooling?
Yeah. We'd like to keep them hours for a little bit longer.
Huh?
We'd like to keep them hours for a little bit longer.
Right? They do good. We got them a piano, so they started learning how to play the piano and stuff like that. It's one of the kind that shows you where to put your fingers on, you know what I mean, with the keyboard. So they're doing really good with it. He's picked up pretty good. He's doing real good. But Malachi is more like the symphony type player, real slow and mellow. And this guy just wants to see how fast he can go, you know. So he'll take the slow songs and speed them right up, you know.
Going to be a disco player.
I loved the video of you saying the commandments, though.
What's that?
The video that you put on YouTube of you reading the commandments.
Oh, yeah. No, that was,
Yeah, she's had, she does really well now, but she's having a hard time with reading. And one night she asked to, read the scripture, or read the Deborah 5. And so we're like, yeah, because we wanted to encourage her to read. And she was just spouting it off, word for word, word for word. And I noticed she wasn't even looking at the book. She wasn't even looking at the scriptures. And I'm like, are you reading? And she's like, yeah. And I'm like, no, you are not. I could not believe that she had the whole thing memorized just from listening to her. Yeah, just from back there reading it to him every night.
Wow. Fantastic.
I mean, it just brought tears to her eyes, you know. And now she's just like, and I try it, and it's like, I can't even remember.
Good memories, haven't I?
Yeah.
That's amazing.
So. How are your schooling?
Sorry, it's breaking up a little bit.
Oh, is it?
Because of their noise?
Yeah. Yeah, just okay. Just a second. Josiah, can you take Aaliyah into the TV room? And Micah?
You can go too, because you're playing with a car. It's making it hard to hear.
You're doing very well behind.
You can go.
Don't have a break.
Just don't go to the bedroom until your brain is.
Okay, Lippy, you want to go too, or you want to stay?
Go on, go watch the TV.
Yes, like you gotta be quiet. Did you make
over here, see, are the kids going?
Yeah, how's it going?
I'm gonna have the kids say goodbye to them. Goodbye.
Bye.
Say
bye-bye.
Come in, Joe, so I'll tell you why.
We're in front of the camera. Say bye.
Goodbye.
Bye.
Is that Micah right beside you?
That's Micah here.
Okay. Aaliyah,
go outside.
Bye, Luca. Bye, Aaliyah.
Bye.
Bye, Brandon.
Bye-bye.
We're going to play.
Thanks, mate.
See ya.
Bye. Bye.
What time is it there at the moment?
It's 6:30.
6:30.
Okay.
Yeah, they'll probably head to bed in about an hour.
Okay, cool.
They go to bed about 7:30.
Okay. Do all of them go to bed at the same time?
Yes.
Oh, that's great.
Yeah.
Because our boys go to bed at 7. Aaliyah usually goes to bed a bit earlier because she gets grumpy. But I was starting to think, oh, should we keep Josiah up a bit or, you know. And so many people around us don't actually even believe in bedtimes. So
yeah.
It makes it harder to even know whether I'm putting him to bed too early or. And he tends to take a bit longer to fall asleep. But I think, oh, well, if he's laying in bed, you know, quietly, at least it calms him down before he goes to sleep. So for now, I like 7 o'clock bedtime.
Yeah.
I'd go insane without a bedtime.
Yeah.
Yeah, we always learn from the beginning because we don't have any family or friends close to us. So we've always put the children to bed early. So we have our time in the evening and chill out time so we don't go insane.
Yeah, yeah, we're the same. Totally understand that. And then there's so many people who are just like, oh, why would you have a bedtime? Just let them stay up till they want. And I've got one friend who ends up at 10 o'clock begging her children to go to bed because she wants to go to bed. I'm sitting there going, when do you have any time to yourself and space? And people wonder how I get everything done that I do, but I'm like, well, that's because we have a bedtime.
Yeah.
At bedtime,
yeah.
I can do my things.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, the kids, they need to get to bed. You know, it's just, otherwise their behavior is just all over the place.
Yeah, absolutely. Isn't that beautiful? She's so gorgeous.
She doesn't always go to bed. She, her bedtime's a little different. Sometimes she'll be in bed by 7:30, and sometimes it won't be till, depending on when she takes a nap.
So now, do you guys get your camper yet?
We're actually picking it up in a week and a half.
Awesome.
We haven't got a car yet. My Mark's parents, were going to come pick it up with us, with their car, but they don't have electric brakes. So a friend of theirs who tows a caravan has electric brakes on his car, and he's going to come and pick it up with us, and then we'll bring it back to the house, and then we can open it up and work it out, like put in everything we want until we're ready to go. So the plan is that we'll either get a car when the salon sells, or we should have enough money to get a car by the beginning of next year if we're still here and haven't sold yet. So, and then we can start going away, you know, for a few days here and there with it and practice runs if we're still waiting for the salon to sell. So we're very, very excited.
So you guys have a vehicle now, or?
No, we don't. We don't have one at all. We sold our car about 6 months ago. It was due for registration, and it was, my brother's a mechanic, and he said that it was going to need replacing soon because it was just really old. We bought it really cheap when we first moved to Sydney, and everyone was saying to us, you shouldn't buy such a cheap car, it's only going to last you a couple of months, and it lasted us, what, just over 2 years? So it was like a great car, but we knew we had to replace it, and we couldn't really afford to replace it at the time, and we didn't want to pay out, you know, $1,200 for registration and then have it break down or fall apart in a few weeks. So we made the decision to get rid of it, and we thought we'd save more money that way and, you know, have to walk everywhere so we'd lose more weight. unfortunately, down here you catch public transport everywhere, so you don't walk everywhere anyway because it's too far to walk, so we have to catch buses and trains. But, I mean, it's made us stay at home a bit more because it's not as easy to just go out. And so that saved us a lot of money not having the car. It is inconvenient sometimes, but yeah. So right now, yeah, at the moment we can't really afford to get another one while we're waiting to sell and paying other things and trying to get ready. So
yeah, that's what we're hoping to do, is if this other job works out, you know, just get our bills paid off and just get our financial life. Now, just breaking even, you know?
Yeah.
Like, you just want to hurry up and just get things, I don't know, you know, just got to get it taken care of. you know, the choices we've made and stuff like that. Still got to take care of the bills. Man, that's, you know, we've thought about that, just not going without a vehicle, but my hair would be like that.
Mine has been this week. It's like, normally it's okay, but this week the boys have been particularly feral. So taking them out on a bus and train, and we had to go out for a big trip earlier in the week on a bus and a train and then a train and then, you know, a few different places. And by the time I got home, actually, by the time I was on my way home, I was sitting there on the bus thinking, I just want to burst into tears right here. I'm ready to kill them all. Jumping around. And this is where I was going, I wish we had a car now. And that's honestly the first time in the 6 months where I've thought that, you know, like, I really wish we had a car. Up until then, it's like, you know, it's not, it's a bit more working out and time and scheduling things and stuff. But I've always been like, oh, no, it's okay, it's okay. But this week it's been a bit like that. So then by the end of the week, we had a homeschooling picnic thing on yesterday afternoon. And I said to the boys, we're not going because I can't cope with going out again today, this week. So we ended up just staying at home. So it was good, though, because we got more done and it was easier to relax and stuff and get ready for Sabbath. But, yeah.
That's cool. So how do you like homeschooling?
Sorry?
How do you like homeschooling?
I love it. I mean, some days I feel frustrated and don't want to do anything, and we don't. But I love that it's flexible like that. You don't have to do something every single day, and they're still learning through stuff anyway. And then we sent Josiah to school for a month this time last year, I think it was, when the salon was really busy and Mark didn't want to put on more staff. We decided I'd go in and work. It was when Aaliyah was about 6 weeks old. She was going to come in with me, and the other boys were going to go to daycare, and Josiah went to school for a month. But the daycare thing didn't work out, so I didn't end up going into the salon at all because I was at home with the other boys, and we were just taking Josiah to school, and he was going to a Christian school. And I was just horrified at we'd have to rush to get him to school. Like, you have to be so organized to get there on time. So we're rushing to get to school. And then I don't know what they were doing during the day, but he would come home at the end of the day. By the time we picked him up, it wouldn't make sense because we had to drive 20 minutes to the school. By the time I picked him up, to come all the way back home again, we'd have about 20 minutes at home and I'd have to go pick Mark up from the salon. So we didn't bother coming home. We'd just go and wait at the salon for Mark and we'd sit in the car and they'd have a snack. And so, and then Josiah had like an hour's worth of homework. So we'd get home at about 5:30, 6 o'clock-ish at night. We'd try to do the baths and dinner. I'd be getting dinner ready and we'd be rushing around. And then by 7 o'clock, which is actually their bedtime, and Josiah's exhausted from a big day out, we're trying to sit down and do his homework. So we never end up doing any. And I said to the teacher, look, we can't do homework. When are we supposed to fit that in? And she's like, it's okay, you can ease into it knowing that we were homeschooling before.
He's in kindergarten.
Yeah, he's in kindergarten, you know, the first grade of school. And so after a month of that, I was at my wit's end of stress of it. And I was just like, I can't take this anymore. And we just realized that we weren't getting the kids into a daycare. It wasn't working. So we decided to pull Josiah back out. But I just think people say to me, how do you handle homeschooling? And I think, how do you handle doing the school thing? I just can't cope with it. It's so stressful. And the breaking point for me as well was that they had a performance on at the school. And so I went to watch this performance that Josiah was doing and up on the stage. And everything was, because it was a Christian school, I thought, well, that's better than the public schools. You know, it's safer was my biggest concern. At least he's learning some scripture. We can just tell him some bits are wrong. But everything was just so pagan that he was performing. And they've got these obelisks up on the stage that they're dancing around and stuff because it's a, you know, and I was just sitting there going, this is what he's been learning all week. and I kind of went, then after he'd finished that, I was like in the car bawling my eyes out, going to the salon to see Mark. And I went to see if he wanted to have lunch. And I walked into the salon and one of our homeschooling friends was in there getting her hair done. And she said, oh, we're having a picnic this afternoon. Why don't you come for the afternoon to the picnic? And I said, sure, we'll come with the other boys. And I went there and we saw all our homeschooling friends and I was just like, and they're just totally different people. They're really relaxed and lovely and they're just sort of really laid back and go with the flow and there's no arguments, no dramas. They, accept everybody in that sort of crowd, you know, because everyone's so different. Whereas the school was the totally opposite to that, and they all loved their school. And I just sort of got home and over the weekend started to say to Mark gently, you know, I hate the school thing, and started telling him about it. And so by the end of the weekend, Mark was like, yeah, it's really not working, is it? And we decided to pull him out. And we went into the school on that next day, and I said, we're pulling him out. This will be his last week. I'll let him have a week here. I know I've got to pay another term's worth of fees, but I don't care. I'm pulling him out. And they were most offended, you know, that I didn't think they were wonderful. But it was such a relief. Oh, my goodness, it was a relief to get him out of there. So I could never do school again. Never. It was horrible. And just that I didn't feel like I knew Josiah anymore. I didn't know what he did in a day. And when I'd say, oh, what did you do today? Oh, I don't remember. And like, so I didn't know what he was doing. I didn't know what he was learning and the people he was mixing with. And the daycare experience that we had was horrifying, the kids that Luca had been mixing with, to the point where I thought, is Josiah having experiences like this at school and what's going on? And it may seem overprotective, but I just sort of thought I wanted to be there. And I didn't want to lose that relationship with him, that we no longer talked about stuff and we didn't, you know, his friends were cool, the teacher was cool, but me, I'm just mum, you know, and I'd hated that. So that was a long story about why we like homeschooling.
No, that's cool. It's a, you know, schools today anymore is just, why would you even, you know, people ask us, you homeschool? Oh, your kids are not learning how to socialize.
Yeah, socialize.
You know? That one, hey.
Oh, you mean he's not learning how to hold a 9mm and selling drugs and all that? I mean, you know, it's ridiculous, man. It's public schools, you know, sometimes our kids will play out here with the neighbor kids. And I mean, the language is just incredible, you know. It's like back inside, you know, and feel bad because it's for some reason when our kids go outside, every kid in the neighborhood comes outside. You know, like right now it's nobody out there, but the minute our kids are outside, about 10-15 minutes, you got 20 other kids out there.
Yeah, we always say all the neighbor kids are knocking on our door for our children to play out with them.
But, you know, you hear the, I mean, it's just like, wow, you know, really? He said that? And I'm like, guys, come on in. You know, it's just, it's real bad. It's just, you know, and my kids, they don't understand sometimes, which is good, you know. You don't need to understand, just don't worry about it, come on in. So, you know, we got a little fenced in backyard where they'll go out there and stuff like that. I mean, homeschooling is the way to go. You know, it's just.
We've met a couple believers, a couple families down here, and they have the one family has children that are younger than ours. Their children they have three, a year old, 3 years old, and 5 years old, all girls. And so, you know, we meet with them every once in a while. And then another family that we've met with, they have 13-year-old twins and a 10-year-old. Actually, I think he just turned 11, and a 4-year-old daughter. So they at least get a few kids to play with that are well-mannered.
They're the same way. This year we're going to be going to, where's that at?
Missouri for Feast of Tabernacles.
So, yeah, we're excited because the kids are actually going to be around other kids that believe the same way they do, you know.
Yeah, that'd be lovely.
Sometimes they'll sit out there and a lot of the kids, they go to, you know, the circus and stuff like that. Kids will sit there, oh, no, that's not his name. His name is Yahusha, you know, and Yahoo? Who's that? You know? And, yeah, are you Jewish or something? And my oldest son, man, he'll sit there, no, that's not his real name. You know, his real name is Yahuwah and it's Yahusha, and those are pagan names. And I'm like,
We heard that one too. Sometimes I can't say that much.
Oh, yeah, you just don't want to go telling people that, you know? Have their dad out here with a shotgun or something, you know? Because these people here, man, they take it seriously, you know? And
yeah. Did you call my son a pagan?
Yeah, it is like. And, you know, and sometimes we'll be like at the store. And one time we were at the store and it's like they're coming out with the pagan claws and all that. Like right now, you know, you see the trees and all that. And we're like, wow, that is, what are we, August? Yeah, and then Dante, the youngest son, he comes out. He goes, Daddy, is that Halloween stuff? You know, there was another lady looking back like, Halloween, you know? No, this is, you know, Xmas, you know? And it was like, what's he doing thinking this is Halloween stuff, you know? And he's like, oh, that's pagan, right, Daddy? I'm like, shut up! I hear! But it's funny, you know, they just innocently just blurted out, you know? And it's like,
it's good.
You don't want
yeah, it
this.
I encourage it, and he's more like, shut.
You know, it's like you want to encourage it, but.
You don't want to get him killed.
Yeah.
Exactly.
Exactly. You know, pretty soon you'll have social services knocking at your door. You know, why is your son calling Halloween Christmas? You know, and that's just the way people think, you know. Kids don't know what that kind of stuff is, and you're abusing them, you know, and it's, they don't get it, you know.
When the boys' friends have birthdays and things, and they'll go, oh, it's my birthday, and I do this, the boys go, oh, birthdays are naughty. Their friends go, birthdays aren't naughty, I like birthdays. And then we have to go and explain, but I can just hear all these conversations going on. I'm sitting there going, okay, they don't understand, you know. But we have to go explain to them, you know, why it's naughty, because then the kids sit there going, but we get presents and we get cake and we get lollies. It's, how can that be naughty? And the boys are going, presents, cake, lollies. I think I like that. And so I go, yes, but you get cake and presents and lollies and things like that all year round. They only get it one day a year.
Yeah. We don't make a big deal out of it. You know, we let them know, hey, it's another year, stuff like that. And, we might go out to eat or something like that, but as far as all that other stuff, and we let them know, you know, and they seem to take it. You know, oh, yeah, well, we don't want to do that then if that's bad, Dad. We don't want to do that.
Yeah.
So, you know, I'm real grateful that they have that attitude, you know, and that, you know, but then they hear the other kids and it's like, I don't know, you know, sometimes it's, I don't know. It's just, but I'm just really glad. It was hard for us, you know, because we grew up in the other side, you know, and to try to make those transition. I'm so glad that our kids are growing up believing what we believe now, as opposed to having to deal with the you know, the baggage and all that stuff. And so they take it like, oh, okay, well, if that's bad, we don't want to be doing that. No, we don't. You know, you can't go telling everybody either. You got to settle down a little bit. But Malachi, man, he's just a little, I mean, he'll just tell people, you know, it's, and he, you know, he doesn't do it like to just, you know, he just, to him, it's just.
He really wants them to learn and to know.
Yeah. And sometimes he'll, you know, they'll be out there talking to their little friends, he'll come running in. He'll come inside and like, and then he'll leave with the scriptures, you know.
Oh, how gorgeous!
Like,
so yeah, what? He goes right out there and shows them right in scripture where it says this, and that.
Oh, wow.
Look at the window, and we're listening, you know, and there's Malachi. Yeah, see, look right there. It's Yahusha. It's not Jesus. Jesus is pagan. No. We don't. Don't say that, and you know, there'll be the little girl. Oh well, I love Jesus, you know. But yeah, it's just, I was like, man, that is so cool. You know what I mean? It's, I just hope and pray that he keeps it up, you know.
He's the oldest, and he loves reading. Whatever he reads, he remembers. He probably knows more scripture than I do, because everything, I don't remember scripture. I'll read it, and I get it, but I would never be able to, I can't remember where it's at and where to find it. He remembers it all.
He'll come up to me, ask me like these $20 questions, you know. I'm like, well, son, hold on just a second. Been here so long. And I was like, where's Lou White when you need him? My gosh, he would know that. But, I mean, he'll ask really, man, pretty profound questions, you know. And it's like, wow. No, I mean, where does he get that? You know what I mean? It's just questions that he's asking now is what I'm asking now.
Yeah.
At a later age, and he's doing it now. And it's pretty cool, though, you know. I'm glad he's asking those kind of questions rather than other questions. But I just hope, you know, our thing is, we want to be on the road, you know, get an RV and just do that full time, you know. And we're just trying to figure out how we're going to make money doing that, you know. One thing we like, well, you know, we're not going to have this bill, we're not going to have that bill, but we don't necessarily have to be making as much as what we think we have to be making.
Yeah.
Just enough to pay for the fuel and or the petrol and to get here and there, you know, but, it, you know, it doesn't matter. Father's going to take care of all that when the time comes anyways. So, just tired. So, now, you do hair too, Amy?
I did start doing an apprenticeship, and I got close to the end, but honestly, I wouldn't do hair now, because I feel sorry for the person sitting there. I wasn't in it for long enough that I could just pick it up that easily now, after being, a year and a half or something since I've really gone into the salon and done much. So once I was I was doing my apprenticeship, but when I fell pregnant with Aaliyah, we decided that I would stay at home. With, you know, five kids, I'd stay at home, so I'd stop doing it. So since that, I've just been a mum and haven't really thought about hairdressing.
When me and Teresa, when we first got married, we moved to Florida, and in Tampa, Florida. And we worked together at a golf course. And then she got pregnant. She worked all the way up until a week or two?
8 months.
8 months? Yeah, she worked all the way up to her 8 month with Malachi. And then after that, it's like, you're staying home. You know? So that's the way to do it.
Yeah.
It's pretty cool. You know, the world would look at us and think, you guys are weird, man.
Yeah.
What's wrong with you people? She doesn't work? You mean? What are you guys doing, you know? You know? The way it is, the way it's supposed to be.
It's great pressure. It's learning how to handle the great pressure and be organized and, get your whole life in order. That's what we've discovered. The last few weeks, I've just been drilling it into the boys. Look, we're about to hit the road soon. You can't have all this mess and all this crap everywhere. Everything's got to be organized and in order. You wake up, get all your clothes in order, go to sleep. You get up in the morning, get your clothes in order for the night. And getting them into sort of a moving around, camping sort of routine. You can't have stuff everywhere. If you hit rain or something, you got to go straight away. So now you got to have all your stuff. You're all going to have a little bag each. You're going to have some clothes in it. This, that. You got to make sure everything's in the bag, because you know how it is. You got a fairly big house, and you know they got toys galore, and they're allowed to do what they want sometimes, and they just, you know, kids are like, they just take advantage of it, and so. We're getting in the routine now of, like I said, bringing some scripture in, bringing, you know, because prior to this, it was just all chaos. you know?
Yeah.
And so you're trying to lose weight and you're trying to get everything in order, and there's so many things. You look at your whole life and you go, where do you start, you know? And prior to this, I was just so engrossed in all my video stuff that I just thought, I don't even want to know about that. That's just chaos. I got my little order and routine here. The videos are going out. And you realize that you're starting to enter into a delusion. And your life, which is reality, is just going down. And you're ignoring it while you're in dreamland with this global audience, you think. And I mean, there's global, and you know, and people are tuning in, and that's great. And a lot of people need that. But it's time to look at my life, and Yahusha showing me lots of things, like if the salon goes down, what's going on? You know, like what's going on with the staff? What's going on with the clients? You know, because my mind's always on, you know, what I'm going to do on the next video. You know, like it's not here in reality. So Yahusha's been putting us through a big cleansing process because of our stupid decision. I mean, we did it to ourselves, but it's been full on the last few months. Just making decisions and what are we going to do here and what are we going to do there. And, but it's really, you know, that's the thing with the children as well. We realised children's behaviour has changed dramatically because we were giving them all organic food, feeding them all organic. Whole foods, nothing unhealthy, nothing processed, no preservatives. We were doing that for months and their behavior just changed. But then, you know, we were neglecting other areas of our life and things in the salon, so it was getting really tight. We were like really getting broke. And so you can't afford organic food if you're broke. You can't afford all these things. So you just got to, you start seeing things on special. Oh, white bread, cheap, grab it. You know, all these things. And so the kids, they're just doing cartwheels off the ceiling now.
Hence our experience this week.
Yeah.
That's why we're just like, get out of here. Go watch the TV. Go watch the TV. Because we're just, you know, can't wait to get them out on the road. Like, just see the lake, see the trees, see the forest. Go and play in the forest, you know.
Yeah.
And, we took them up to our parents' holiday house at the beginning of this year, and there was just forests and lakes and swimming pool, and you know, and they didn't once ask for food. They didn't once ask for entertainment, no TV. They didn't ask for toys. They didn't ask for anything. They were totally, and
that's. We did feed them though.
We did feed them, but it's like.
They just didn't complain for food. Just,
and so we, that's what sort of got in my mind, and I thought, you know, the behavior was different. I thought, we got to get them out of here. You know, what's life about? You know. Slaving away in a system, slaving away trying to possibly acquire stuff, acquire nice things and cars and houses and things, and you just look at it. And I've got friends and parents and other people who have all those things, and yeah, it's lovely. It's lovely if you come into Yahusha with those things, but you just look like it's going to end soon. The world's going to end soon, you know, and prior to recently, we'd been using that as an excuse to make stupid decisions. Oh, it's going to end anyway. But now it's like, you got to live like it's going to keep going and make wise decisions and tarry on or occupy until it comes. But as far as the worry about the future, like, no. We just fill them with the Torah, and that's, you know, what else can you do? You know, they're going to, I look at other believers who have believing parents and, you know, all different walks of life, and I think, well, they've had to go out and have their own experiences, you know, and they always come back. They have their experiences. They make decisions. They might enter into sin, different sorts of sins. But if they've got the Torah in them, you know, as a parent, I guess you just got to watch that happen and pray for them and know that you've done the hard work when they're young. And so far, we don't feel, our conscience isn't clear as far as that's concerned. I mean, I know my oldest is only 7, but that's 7. Like, that's 7 years. Like, that was yesterday, you know, when he was born. So I think in 4 or 5 years, he's going to be a teenager. Like, so it's really woken us up now. Like, it's time to change. It's time to, you know. We'll be in the salon as long as we need to be, but there's more important things in life. I mean, I know you've got to make wise decisions, but and stop spending money, you know, stop wasting money, you know. If you don't got it, don't spend it, you know. Live off the smell of an oil rag, and it's taken us, you know, since we've been married, people have been telling us that. But you got to go through all those things, I guess, you know.
You have to experience it for yourself to understand.
Yeah, you have garage sales and you go, what's all this crap? You know,
yeah.
All the stuff we bought, you know, and you find it and you go, they've never used it. You know, some of
it doesn't take long either, man.
Hey?
It doesn't take long to add up either.
Yeah, no. And you just had to have it. Had to have it. Flesh is insatiable, you know. And half the time the kids weren't even old enough for that stuff. It was us. You know, they were always doing that.
Right.
Yeah. Two-size one-year-old and we buy him a bike. It's like, it's insane.
No, when we moved here, it was funny because we bought a camper, a pop-up, you know, and that one was a lot bigger than the first one we did. I mean, the first one we got, our kids were real small when we moved to Virginia from Michigan, and that was a small camper. But man, it was a good time, you know. I'm a city boy, you know. I'm born and raised in the city. I still to this day don't like, never fished. I won't touch the worms. Won't be doing that. But my wife, she's a country girl, you know, born country and out in the open, and never been camping until I met her, you know. Once I did that, I was like, yeah, man, this is the way to do it right here, man. And it's just, you know, people are like, well, you know, you guys are going to be doing that, you know, I mean, you guys ain't going to have room and all this. I'm like, yeah, so, you know, and people just don't get it, you know, they think we're crazy, so.
All you need is a bed, and then the room, then your activities and fun and life is outside.
Yeah. Yeah, when we first moved here, we parked our camper at friends that we met, and we literally walked in here with a backpack, and we were moved in. That was it. And now, you know, me and my wife were like, we're getting ready to move. It's like, where did all this stuff come from? Yeah, I mean, now it's like we're crowded. We walked in here, we didn't have nothing for furniture, you know, and we got this for free. We got washer for free, dining table for free. From strangers, from people we didn't even know. You know, like, hey, you need this? We're like, well, yeah. The couch is not that comfortable, but you know, it's new. I go, well, we've been sitting on the floor, so that's gonna be comfortable for us. Oh, well, here you go. You know, and I was like, now we're like, my gosh. You know, it's like you have a house just to have your stuff in it. You know. That's it. But so we're hoping to get our camper here real soon. And when we didn't get a new vehicle. We got a used vehicle, new for us. But we got a Suburban, so we can tow a big camper, you know. And so, you know, little by little, we're taking steps. And we're a pretty big family. We had a little Saturn before. That was crowded. And then towards the last minute when we decided to trade it in, I mean, everything on it started breaking down. Air conditioner went out. And here in I noticed you guys are wearing sweaters.
Oh, yeah, winter.
Yeah, it's winter for you guys over there, right? Yeah, no, it's hot here. It's been like 100, 111 Fahrenheit. Yeah, so it's been hot. And,
45.
But so it's going to be exciting, you know, once we get to hit the road and just that kind of stuff. Just let the kids be kids, you know, do the campfire. When do you guys think you'll be on the road?
Well, we have to sell it on the market now. Our lease runs out here in a few months. We'll stick around as long as we need to.
So just wait for the salon to sell?
Just wait for the salon to sell. Yeah. So
time, basically.
Keep going until it happens. Keep we put a couple of new staff on, and I'll just train them up, and you know. So it's good to have a pumping business for someone to buy, you know. So.
Yes, a lot is really open.
Yeah, it's big.
Yeah, it's real open. I saw the video that you did. The I shouldn't be talking about this. It's your guys' Shabbat. I saw the one video you did, like the tour through the salon and stuff. I mean, that was really nice. And you guys live upstairs, right, on top of the salon?
We did.
Oh, you did?
We first opened.
Yeah.
For 6 months, but we were in an apartment. Like, there's a whole lot of apartments above it. We were in an apartment up on the top level. And then when I fell pregnant with Aaliyah, and I was going to stay at home with the kids, we decided, yeah, I couldn't get upstairs anymore, far out. It was exhausting. But we decided to move to a house with a proper backyard and everything because the kids were going to be at home all the time, because at that stage they were going to daycare or grandparents a few days a week. So then we moved to a house. So we're about, 10 minutes away from the salon now, in a house with a backyard and stuff so the kids can play and have more space, and it's a big house.
Yeah.
Too much space.
Yeah. You got it.
How did you guys come to the truth and all that?
To Yahusha?
Yeah.
Yeah. We were in the circus. We were in a little... When I started working at the salon with Chris and Victoria years ago, I was an apprentice. I was going to fix the baby.
Yeah.
Baby's bedtime.
Jesus, putting our baby to bed too.
Yeah. I started working at the salon with Chris and Victoria in Seven Hills in Sydney about 18 years ago as an apprentice. And I was just insane, just nuts. And but they Chris used to be a Pentecostal pastor. And
oh, yeah.
They'd had their circus split up and fighting and all bickering, and the circus turned against them and, you know, all that sort of thing. So that split up, and they'd had enough of Christianity, enough of religion. So they'd spent a couple of years after that just sort of in business, just working, trying to get ahead, do their house up a bit so they could just get ahead. Didn't want to know about the circus. And so here I come along as a Protestant. I was a... Anglican / Circus of Christ, and you know, full of myself and a musician and all this sort of thing, worship leading and jumping off stages and all this crazy stuff they did, and but I had no idea about the spiritual gifts and stuff that the Pentecostals are into. So they, Chris said to me one day, "Are you spirit filled?" And I said, "Yeah, I'm a Christian." "No, he's spirit-filled." And then the argument started for months and months and months and months and months and months. But eventually, I was having this relationship with the Creator and I was in charge. And I said, you know, if you really want me to go this way, then give me a sign. And this is all this crazy way you're talking.
And yeah.
Things went wrong in my life. And so I ended up going. I got immersed in the name of the LJC. And... went and had a at the back of Chris and Victoria's house and got filled with the Spirit and speaking in tongues and then Victoria fixed me up a scotch. It's a good night.
That's fun.
And that and then Chris and Victoria and their close friends Del and Ray, they were two other people who had stuck by them when the other circus had fallen apart. They then came together, and I had all these four or five or six or seven friends that had followed me, and sort of because I'd had this massive change, like I was just like, you know, excited and full on and tongue talking and all this madness. And so I had lots of friends that followed me and with no direction. And so Chris sat down with Victoria and Del and Ray and said, "Look, these young guys seem pretty full on, and do you think maybe we're being called back into this again? You know, this is our last chance to do it right this time." And still in Christianity, but, and so we agreed, they agreed to help us, and so we started having little meetings in their lounge room, on this very lounge, and that was when the circus started, and all my mates, eventually, as we started getting very full on in the Christianity, we like, started reading the Kevin Connor books, and no alcohol, and no nothing, it was really strict, you know, and so my friends eventually, one at a time, fell away, and girlfriends and friends and relatives, they all fell away, so it was just me, and Del and Ray and Chris and Victoria and their son Matthew, and so we just kept going along, and people started to join one by one, and my best friend Jason, he came along, not long after that he met his wife Yuli, and we just kept going, and we were in this Indonesian circus at that point, because the people that brought Chris and Victoria into Christianity 30 odd years ago was this little Indonesian man and his wife, Max and Shinny. So we went back to them, and we thought, well, there's only a handful of us, we'll go and join this big Indonesian circus. And at the time they were going through seeking the truth as well in Christianity, and so a lot of their circus fell away as well, so it got smaller, and this little Indonesian man handed Chris a book called Fossilized Customs, and it was just another book to us. I think Max had, I don't know if Max had read it or not, but it sat there for a while, and Chris eventually read it and just blew the top of his head off, you know, like we were just, because he and Victoria were more into truth than the status quo. Even in Christianity, we were like full on, like seeking the truth. What's the truth about this? Why not just for the sake of it? Like a lot of Christians don't even read the scripture. They're just, it's part of it. It's like a country club.
Yeah.
It's a social thing. Whereas they were very full on, like in the scripture. And so when this book came along, they were just full on. And so we all had to read it. I remember sitting in our little apartment in Seven Hills, reading this book with this tiny writing.
Yeah.
Going, what on earth is this? You know? And half of it doesn't even touch the sides the first time you read it. And so eventually we went to the Indonesian circus, and we said to them, and they were having dramas and things at the time, and we eventually started mentioning things like this, and they didn't really want to know about it. And so eventually there was more drama, and we just... Chris and Victoria said to us, the small group that had started out here, they said, look, we're going to split away. It's just too much pressure. So we split away and just continued studying and meeting. And we went through the beginning of the scriptures, the ISR scriptures, and about the name. And I think we first got immersed in Yeshua, and then it was Yahushua, and then it was, you know, and then we came in Yahushua, and now it's Yahusha. And I think that's the clearest understanding now. so yeah, and that was that. And around about that time too, a lot of the banks moved from Seven Hills, from where the shops were. So once the banks moved, there's not as many people walking around in the streets. They all went over to the mega, over to the shopping center. And so the clients were sort of, the salon was going down a bit. So Chris and Victoria decided it was time to sell up as well. And we went up to Cairns a bit earlier than they did because we were just impatient and, you know, excited and insane. And we spent years up there moving around, making stupid decisions, moving from house to house when we didn't need to. We'd see another house on the market for rent that was better than ours, so we'd pack up and move to that one. Excuse me a second. Can you be quiet? Thank you. So we get the, you know, and eventually, you know, always complaining about something, you know, life was, you know, life owed us something, and always looking for a handout, didn't want to, you know, work hard. And so you shows you, you know, we thought we were clever because we were going to sidestep having to go into a mortgage and be, you know, tight and, you know, living off the smell of an oil. I really don't need to do that. We're not going to buy a house, you know. We'll just live how we want. But if you don't treat the clients right and you're not into them totally and you've got other plans and other ideas, it's, you know, it just, everything goes down. So you go through that experience anyway. So Yahusha's been teaching us big time, just how to behave and how to run things properly and how to do everything right. So that's how we came into the truth. We all came in together, and now they're all up in Atherton in Queensland, and we're back there in here. So it's the end.
That's pretty cool. You guys all did it together and supported each other and all that.
Yeah.
We were, when we moved to Florida, we went to a circus there. What was it? First Church of God. And we were there for a while. But then we started doing this home group, you know. And we were doing the home group thing for a long time, you know.
Were you in the little group too?
Yeah, we were like home group. And that's where we also learned about home birth and stuff like that, you know, before we had our first son. And my wife was married, I mean, my sister.
My wife was married to my sister. Married.
He's my only husband.
But my sister's ex-husband, he was a lightweight atheist, you know, and he used to get into it with my dad, because my dad was a hardcore preacher at the time, you know. And they live in Ohio, another state. We were in Florida. So one day my dad calls me, Hector. I'm like, yeah, what's wrong? You got to read this book. And I'm like, okay. And, you know, when you're in the circus, books are everything but the scriptures, you know. You're reading every other book out there but the scriptures, you know, the one you're supposed to be reading. He's like, okay, well, what book is that, you know? And he goes, it's called Fossilized Customs. Fossilized Customs. I'm like, okay. Yeah, I go, you know, he goes, you got to buy it. It's just, so, you know, we went, got online and went to the website. And did we call him? Or did
we had to order over the phone, I think.
Yeah, we actually called. And I remember speaking with Phyllis. I didn't know who she was at the time. But now that I know who she is, I remember that's the lady I spoke with. So I ordered a book from Phyllis, and then we're like, we'll get that little sticker banner, you know, with the menorah and all that. Oh, that's pretty cool. We'll get that too. Yeah, whatever. Ordered the book, and then the book finally came. And man, I was messed up. I was reading it, and I thought the same thing too. What book is this? You can't even read it. Look at this print, man. Are you kidding me? I mean, you know, then all the little characters on there, and I'm like, what kind of, you know, little pamphlet? I'm thinking, man, I'll read through this in one night, you know? Hey, Mark, it took me 6 months to get through that book. I started reading it, and I could not put it down, man. I was like, it felt like, you know, mad, angry, you can't believe it. But then at the same time, you're thinking, I knew it. You know?
Yeah.
And I would tell my wife, I would read one thing. Oh, my gosh. Did you know? Because my dad used to wear that clergy outfit, you know, with the little white deal on there. And
don't call up.
Yeah. So I'm like, did you know what that was? And my wife thought I lost it, you know. And then when the part came about the cross,
oh,
buddy, yeah. He's up the devil. I rebuke you. And I'm like, no way. I don't know. This is where I draw the line right here. You're not going to take my cross, you know. And I was like, really, man? Then I got online. I'm thinking, no, this guy has got to be wrong. You know, this is. It's like we were. I was excited. You know, it's like I knew something was wrong, kind of a feeling. But But then it's like, but it can't be, you know?
Yeah.
Because what made it really hard for me, my dad was a preacher, you know? So.
And he gave you the book.
Huh?
And your dad gave you the book.
Yeah, and my dad gave me the book. My sister's ex-husband, the atheist, gave him that book.
Oh, your dad hadn't read it?
No. He gave it to my dad because it was trashing Christianity.
Yeah.
In his eyes. So, you know, he's like, hey, his name was Robert. You need to read this book, you know. It'll teach you. And my dad read the book. And then that's when my dad called me. And this is what he says, Hector, all the stuff we've ever believed in, it's all wrong. I'm like, what?
So your dad is guy.
Yeah, my dad.
He's an atheist.
He's not.
Your dad
is not a
Wow.
So he gave me the, he told me about the book. Then we ordered it and read about the cross, and that right there is like, and I told my wife, I'm like, do you know the cross is wrong? And you know, you tell that to a Christian, buddy, that it's over, you know? And Teresa thought, I mean, what'd you think?
That's been so long. That was back in 2000. So that's been, it's been a long time. I can't really remember. I do know it took them so long to read the book because it took them that long to process each thing they were learning.
Yeah.
And for me, I was in between. I didn't know if it's true or not. Even when I would look stuff up on the internet and read things, I'm like, well, you can also read that it says this. What's the truth? But one thing I did know was there was nothing wrong with saying, at that time, I think, it was Yahweh and Yeshua.
Yeah.
I knew there was nothing wrong with saying that, but I wasn't sure. I was starting to get convicted about saying Jesus. I wasn't sure if that was right, knowing that the letter J was only 500 years old, or not even. So for me, I was just thinking, well, you know, I know I'm not doing any wrong by saying Yeshua and Yahweh. So that's really how I took it in. And it was just a gradual process just to soak everything in, look everything up, and doing the research yourself, not just thinking. At that time, you know, a lot of times you just took it for what the preacher said and for what the friend said and other book you suggested. So when we got this book and we were reading it, then we really started looking up on our own on what the truth was. And
it took me a long time to read the book. One, the print so small, but it was just, you know, and to process it, I mean, you know, it was huge. I mean, something I grew up with, something my dad taught.
Yeah, he grew up with his father being a preacher. I grew up Catholic. So, and I was already brought out of that, and we met at a non-denominational circus. So,
non-denominational. Isn't that
weird? Yeah.
Yep.
Convenient, isn't it?
Yeah. Then we can just do whatever we want.
Yep, exactly. But, yeah, man, that book, it was just blew me away, you know. It's just, and then here's the funny thing. Oh, man, you know, when I was listening, to your testimony on the branches of Yahusha, you know how you start learning all this stuff and you start wanting to do the Christian thing and go witness, you know? And we went to our little group and we're like, hey, all this stuff we believe in is all wrong, man. I said, you got to listen to this. And, you know, we came across a tape. I don't know if you still remember those. The actual cassette player.
Yeah.
We had one of those of Michael Rood? Michael Rood or Monte Judah, one of those two guys. Yeah, we didn't know any better. You know what I mean? We just knew that they were Jewish, and they said Yeshua, Yahusha, whichever one. That's all we knew, you know, so they got to be right. But, you know, the group came, and the senior of the group, she was an elderly lady, real sweet lady, you know, and this day, we haven't heard from them in a while, but they came, and buddy, we were like, what, 2 weeks from getting the left foot of fellowship? We decided to leave before they kicked us out. So, but we had, you know, we had heard that there was a conspiracy going on to, we were just getting to be too far-fetched for them, you know, and we started telling them, oh man, you can't eat pork, you know, you can't eat pork. In the meantime, there's a tray of sliced pepperoni with Ritz crackers on the table there. And I, oh no, we can't eat pork, you know, and all of a sudden it was just, you know, we were by ourselves after a while. That didn't take long. And then we went through a really long period of, I don't know.
It's like mourning. It's like a mourning where you don't, when circus has been your whole life.
Yeah.
Almost every single day and night, and like that. You go through a period where you just don't want to know about any of it.
Yeah. We were stuck in, I don't know, just, we didn't know what to believe anymore. You know what I mean? It's, yeah, I mean, just like you said, the circus was our everything, and it's like the carpet got snug from underneath us. And
well, you have all those relationships you have built, and you're really close to the people.
Yeah.
And then when you believe something so outrageous, and they don't show you any love. They don't show you any compassion. They just judge you and kick you to the curb and warn everybody else to stay away from you and to not believe what you're telling them. And so,
you learn real quick who your friends and family really are. You know, it didn't take long for us to get judged and can't be having this stuff, you know. And but yeah, we went through a long time of I started getting stupid, you know, and just doing things my way and not caring, you know. And I mean, I don't know, it was just, but past is the past, you know. And
that's normal.
And then, you know, we started watching a lot of the Lou White videos, your videos and stuff like that. And I mean, that really helped me a lot. You know, it really did. And I know that all the esteem goes to Yahusha, you know, but I am really grateful that the Father has put that ministry in your heart, you know, because it has helped me a lot. It really has, you know, and it has helped me to grow, you know. I like reading books, you know, and but to be able to just go to YouTube and hear it, you know, because Scripture says that belief cometh by hearing, and hearing by the word of Yahusha, you know. I mean, reading, yeah, you're reading, but when you hear it, that's where your belief starts to build up, you know. And the videos that you were putting out, it really has ministered to me a lot. It's helped me to grow as a believer, you know. It has helped my family. And, you know, one day I just hope, you know, that I get to meet Lou White face to face and just shake his hand for being so bold, you know, because saying what he says, and it's not that he's saying it, but hey, basically he's just revealing what's already there. And for somebody to stand up and just say, look, to have the cojones to tell people how it is, it's not easy, you know? And when I hear people slandering him, you know what I mean? I know how much he's hurting, you know? And it's like, because my dad's been through that, you know, even though it wasn't the circus. At that time, that was his life. At that time, that's all he knew. And to him, he was doing the right thing, you know? And so, you know, you just get people, I mean, the circus are just ridiculous, you know? And now that I know what I know, I understand that, you know what I mean? That it's just, but at that time you don't. You just think that you're doing the right thing. You think you're going to heaven, you know, and people would attack him because my dad was the same like Chris, you know. He was in the circus, but to him it was just about the truth. It wasn't about what everybody else was doing and going with the flow. My dad has always been the controversial kind of guy, you know what I mean? He was a Pentecostal preacher, but he was the kind of preacher that would sit there and tell you, you know, sometimes we would go to circuses and right after the meeting, they open up a little vending buffet table right there in the temple, you know, and you're not supposed to be doing that. Oh, Yahusha came and he whipped those people and he kicked tables over and, you know, you just can't be doing that. So, you know, he was that kind of guy that would just, hey, you know, you can't be doing that kind of stuff. We're going to do this. We're going to do it right, you know. And so.
Excuse me a second, Mike. Yeah.
I remember that. It gets a lot easier.
It gets easier, yeah. Does it?
That's why Layla came 7 years later. Our first three, all three were in diapers at one time, and
yeah, understand. Yeah. Ordered chaos.
Got a clan there, buddy.
Now the older ones are watching Layla for me, so I can sit here for a minute.
Well, that's why the love is so important, because we were very young when the truth came to us, and we look back and go, if we hadn't had older people around us who, you know, were like parents to us and, you know, loved us, and it was because of the love. That wasn't a fear or anything like that, or, you know, you have to cut, you know, it wasn't like that. It's because we were all close friends and loved each other, that when the truth came to us, I mean, we might have read it and gone, what's this nut madness? I never read it and never took it seriously. But part of it was that Chris and Victoria went into it and we went too. And we're just so glad we had that close relationship with them, because it was all about the love. And so Yahusha's used that and through ups and downs and, you know, whether you're broke or got an abundance, it's all about the love. And you feel it when there's no love. You feel it when he's, you know, or even when the kids are acting up and you just want to strangle them, that's not love, you know. Like, you feel it and you just think, okay, I'm realizing that he's in charge of everything. Like, I look back to just sitting in my old crappy computer trying to get videos to work, and they would never work because the computer was rubbish. And things like that, and yet that was when I first, oh, thanks. I gotta drink so much water on this diet. I used to be addicted to soft drinks, so it's.
Yeah.
But.
Headaches.
Sorry, your old computer.
Oh, my old computer, yeah. And, but the encouragement I got, you know, like, I'd get encouragement from Chrissy, to see if you can find, you know, movies where people are melting. You know, movies where people are burning up, you know, things like that. And you know, through the process years later, I can't use any of that now. I've had to cut most of them out because of copyright. But at the time, it taught me how to, you know, look for things and, you know, have fun with it and enjoy it and bring Yahusha into it and show people, you know, and a lot of people have seen most of those old videos, you know, where that I put together with them all melting up and burning, you know, people and everything like that. And I even look back to when I first started with Lou and the things I was saying on half the videos, I listen to them now and go, oh, what an idiot. You know, that's not even funny, you know.
I know.
And I just, who the hell was that? You know, like, but I just come into the experience and I just got nothing but encouragement from Lou, like, and Chris and Victoria always encouraging me. Like, encouragement is so important. And so that's why a lot of believers, like, will write in and go, oh, I don't know what I'm supposed to do, or I don't know what my gift is, or I don't know, you know, I'm floundering, da, da, da. I don't even know you guys really. And yet, like, I said to Amy, she knew and I didn't even realize. This guy, this HTV guy who's been commenting on all my YouTube clips is you. I didn't even know. So, because there's so many, in the internet world, there's so many name things that you see, different usernames that you don't know who's who. And until you started coming onto Facebook, and I thought, that's the same guy. That Hector, that's the guy who's been encouraging us for years, writing all these encouraging things on our videos.
I think you commented on something on the Tour Institute page, and I went, hey, that's them. And I quickly friended you, and I said to Mark, hey.
I didn't know you guys had that. I just came across that. I don't know how. I'm like, where's this been? I mean, it's like a whole newsletter thing, a whole different. So when I first commented on that, I forgot what was that about the marijuana deal?
Yeah, I think it was. Yeah.
It was. Oh, that was good, man. That was. We're about to get controversial now. But I used to be big time.
Dopehead.
Yeah, and I tell you, I love Lou's store. I wish I used to go into a lot of them. I mean, a lot. I'm thinking back now, like, man, you imagine back in that time, if I would walk into a store like that and find a guy like Lou White behind a counter? I mean, you know, I mean, really? I mean, how perfect is that? You know, I mean, and that's what blows me away. You get these people criticizing the man. I'm like, what better place to be, you know? I mean, seriously, all the people that are at their lowest point of their life, you know, walk into that store. I mean, what better place is there to be, man, to be at? And I'm like, people, give us a program, man. You know, what are you doing? You're, aside from taking the time, criticizing, slandering somebody that you don't even know. I mean, you know, what are you gaining out of that? I mean, seriously, how stupid and childish and ridiculous is that? I mean, oh, you know, those are the kind of things you deal with in junior high school, when you're a little kid. I mean, you're a grown man now and you're still acting like that? I mean, how ridiculous is that? I mean, you know, I wish there was somebody like that when I was walking into those stores looking for my pack of papers or whatever. You know, I wish I would have ran into somebody like that in a store like that, because that's where I was spending most of my time. You know, I'm thinking, man, that how awesome is that? You know, and then I saw the pictures of all the little bubbles that he has around. I mean, that is hilarious, man. Because
they didn't put any of those in the slander videos, though.
Of course not. No, it's funny because when I saw those pictures, it's like, that's like walking into his book, you know, because that's what his book looks like. I'm thinking, man, that is sweet. And I told Teresa, it's funny because we lived in Ohio, which is the state right above Kentucky where Lou's at. I was like, man, one of these days we got to stop by his store and visit the store and stuff like that. I would love to meet him one day and just shake his hand, you know, and just say thank you. You know? But it, I mean, it, his story is funny, man. I got to talk to him a couple of, I believe Teresa talked to you about, you know, the little issue that we were asking you guys for prayer and stuff like that. And, you know, we just, we had so many questions, why that happened and all that. And I just didn't know how to make any sense of it, you know. It's like we were really, you know, I mean, so I called Lou White, you know, and then he's such an encouragement, you know. In the end, you know, it's just all about love, you know. And it's just funny, you know. This whole time you're in the circus and I don't know. It's just, they make it so hard, a lot harder, you know. They want to talk about you being, you know, under the law. And it's like they're the ones that are bound, you know, by all the circus stuff, all that ridiculous nonsense stuff, you know. And it's like you're more free now, you know. I mean, that's what people say. Oh, well, you're under the law. You're being bound and all this. Shabbat, man, you know. Does it get any better than that? You know, to, like you have permission to kick back, relax, and enjoy yourself, you know. And what we do every Shabbat is, you know, we log into Eliah.com, and, you know, and it's Eliah. We got to meet him in Virginia. He went on a, he had a camper, and he just went around different places and just on the East Coast, and he just started baptizing people and, you know, under the true name. And we were in Washington, D.C. We lived right by Washington, D.C. in Virginia. And we went down there and started handing out tracts, you know, that talked about the real names. And he had made up this CD called the Hebrew Roots of Christianity or something like that. But, you know, and it got people just thinking about it. We got kicked out of a few monuments. We weren't supposed to be doing that, apparently. So we had to go into the common areas, you know, and do that. But real nice guy, you know, real humble. Just, he's funny because he looks like one of the ZZ Top. You know ZZ Top? Yeah. I mean, that thing is like, ah. Sometimes I make fun of him. Hey, you got some birds nesting in there. But he's a real nice guy, man. Real humble, real sweet spirit. And, you know, we like watching his programs on Sabbath. You know, he's real mellow. You know, he speaks in a real love way, you know. And to me, I'm like, my man, say it, you know. But he's just really calm, real easy, you know. As opposed to Lou, he's like, hey, you know, this is the real thing. He takes a different.
Approach. He does some pretty controversial subjects. He just did a teaching not too long ago on oneness, the Trinity, or none of the above, and that
ruffled up some feathers there.
That was a really good study.
Trinity. Well, I know Lou White did one on that too, and it's the same thing, you know. And you know how my dad used to explain that the Trinity was like an egg. You got the shell, the white, and the yolk. Three parts, but they're one. You know, so that's how we made sense out of that. Of course, you know, the Holy Spirit and Jesus. you know, but then to turn out it's all wrong anyways, you know.
Yeah.
I was like, man, there goes the egg. Good way to explain it, and that's no good, you know, but it's funny, you know, it's, then you start thinking about a lot of the other stuff, you know, and it just all makes sense now, you know, why the things were the way they were, you know, and reason why people behave the way they do, this all makes sense, you know, this all makes sense now. That's all. But now, once you start on the road, are you going to still continue the videos, or that's going to be put on hold for a while?
No, we're going to pull back on them a little bit, but we're going to do something different. If we're here a little while longer, I'm going to start working with Adam a bit. He's going to help because they've got this new camera, and I'm finding the Skype starting to break up a little bit a lot when Lou talks and his camera sort of plays up a bit. So we're going to get Adam in there to film, because we did a few Torah talks a couple of months ago and Adam filmed about four, I think, with us, and then emailed his side through, and then I would just join up the conversation. Oh, it's annoying, I swear. I'd love to just go to America so we can sit in the same room.
I know, right?
talk in the same room. And we're going to work with Adam a bit more. And then when we hit the road, it'll pretty much be... That's why I'm trying to catch up with a few more people now, like yourself and others who made friendships with. Because when we hit the road, depending on where you go, it's different connectivity in different parts of Australia. So it's going to be more of a... if we come into a town where there's super connectivity and we stay there a while, I'd be like, hey, let's do a few shows. And then it might be a couple of months where we have no reception whatsoever with anything. So it'll just be more playing it by ear. And there probably won't be any green screens or anything like that. So it's going to be a new chapter of everything then. But
I'm at Terrell.
That's it. We've been watching a few of these docos and... of people that go around of Australia, and some of the productions are just so amateur. We just think we could do that. The kids could say, here we are in Ayers Rock. Isn't it Yahusha wonderful? Look at this, you know, and like you could do things like that and bring the kids in on it. And I've been starting to think now as Josiah gets older that I could start making more of the focus on them. Like instead of thinking, oh, wish I'd learned how to do this. I wish I'd learned how to play, you know, classical guitar. I wish I'd learned how to edit, you know, music better or edit. I wish I'd. I'm thinking, well, I could teach them or get them to know how to do that. And then, you know, you hear of, not that we'd go this way, but you hear of parents who take the step back and their kids become, you know, musicians or whatever. And you know, I could just record them, you know, like it's start putting all those things into them, training them, bringing them into front of camera, like just teaching them how to do things so that they're gifted, you know. They're just things I'm toying with in my head. But getting on the road will just definitely be better. Just cutting hair, you won't have as many expenses, you know.
I noticed on his last seminar video, I thought, man, he must have gotten a new camera because the quality was like, it was good. It was really good. And then with the black background, you know, to where it was just, I was like, yeah, this is nice. Like, we got a new camera because it looked really good. And so she's so cute.
We're so used to seeing all the dark hair and the dark eyes, and all your little ones are the light hair and light eyes. So beautiful.
It's funny.
Hi, Aaliyah.
Now, do you do the one video, the music video that you have?
Kneel on his throne?
Yeah, kneel on his throne.
Yeah. That was so cute. All the kids on there. Then you have the other music video, the witchcraft. That was sweet, my man. That was nice. I like listening to that one. But the one that we have is... we listen to it every once in a while. We got it on the playlist. I listened to it all the time, and now it's just like disappeared. It came off the YouTube for a minute. I'm like, hey, wait a minute. Where's that song at?
Oh, I finally found.
Yes, that one. Oh, that was a good one.
That was an old U2 song, but we saw it live in concert. Cher did it at the beginning of a concert, and I thought that arrangement is better than U2's arrangement. So I thought, I want to record that and change the words.
Oh, that was pretty good. We listen to that one so much now that when we hear the original on the radio, I'm like, hey, that's wrong.
He's still looking.
Oh, and then that new one that you guys did together on, I think you did it on the Two Witnesses, I believe.
Oh, you are.
You have the one background picture that, I go, man, that picture looks
good. Yeah, that was off your profile.
I'm like, I've seen that picture before. But Teresa's like, that's our profile picture. I'm like, what?
I really like that.
But yeah, that song you guys sang together, that was beautiful, man.
Yeah. That was You Are. We actually sung that song to each other at our wedding 9 years ago. So yeah. I had to cut out a couple of the JSUS, you know.
Yeah.
It was a Christian song. But it was all about love, so I loved it. So
no, that was beautiful.
It's been so lovely catching up, guys. Our kids are bouncing off the walls, we're gonna have to say goodbye. We'll have to do it again.
It was good finally to meet
you
guys.
Nice meeting you.
You enjoy the rest of your Sabbath, and thank you for all the encouragement and lovely words. It's been so good.
Yeah. You've been an encouragement to us.
Thanks.
Really appreciate this time to talk to you guys and meet you guys.
Yeah, it's been great. It's
wonderful. Yeah, it's wonderful bouncing ideas off people who are chasing after young children.
Stars to bed and resting.
You guys are just getting your day started.
Yeah, it's nearly lunchtime now. So, yeah.
You guys take care.
All right,
yeah.
You too.
Love you too.
Love you guys. Have a good day.
Bye-bye.
See you later.
I believe in the kingdom come, and all mankind will stand to be judged according to Torah. And this race I'm still running, yeah. Yahusha died and he loosed the chains, carried the burden of my shame, now of my shame. And forever I'll serve him, 'cause I finally found what I'm looking for. Searching for